Welcome to Youth Takeover Sunday. Thank you for joining us. Make sure to like our Facebook and YouTube pages. Now let's get started.
First, let me congratulate the pastor, the leadership, the congregation on its existence for 96 years. Anything or anyone who's been able to be in existence for 96 years deserves to be celebrated. But I think more importantly, as we think about what this church has meant to this community and what the current leadership has done for the community, suggest that this church will be around for another 96 years because the work is extremely important, and without it, this community can't be successful. My relationship with Elm Grove started long before I became a council person. I met Pastor Errol Domingue about 16, 17 years ago as he was the pastor here then, and we were doing some work in the community around voter registration. We were doing some work in the community around police brutality. We were doing work in the community around rights of people in terms of young people for getting a quality education. And so I met him on that journey, and he has always been a supporter and a fighter for that which is right. And so that's where the relationship began. And so once I became a member of the Metro Council, we were able to partner on some initiatives here in the community. And I think Elm Grove and its leadership have always been a part of the community, not just at the church, but out in the community, doing community walks, community cleanups, providing resources and information around economic development, financial literacy. And I think all of those opportunities still exist. And as we are coming out of a pandemic, we have to continue to make sure we provide information and educate the community on what the opportunities are and how we can better support them. And so I look forward to those partnerships and doing that work. Congratulations, Pastor Domingue. Continue to serve. Thank you for being a role model for me and for this community. God bless.
So, based basically, when the pandemic happened, we reached out to a bunch of our community partners, and we wanted to go out into places that we consider underserved in the Baton Rouge region. Our relationship started with providing COVID testing, and from that, we were able to also provide COVID vaccines once they were approved. It's been an amazing partnership. We've been able to provide hundreds of COVID tests, and we've vaccinated over 300 people just doing a couple of events at Elm Grove. So I think when you're looking at that area, it is a highly populated area. So that's a really good number for that neighborhood. One of the things that I remember the most is just being welcomed by Elm Grove. Everyone was pretty afraid. We didn't know what to expect. We had never been through a pandemic. We really didn't know what COVID was. So having someone embrace us and allow us to come to their facility and actually go indoors, we were pretty much on a rotation at Elm Grove, and they welcomed us with open arms so that we can provide this for that community. And that was awesome because at that point we weren't getting a lot of engagement from other churches. So it was really good that we were able to do that. And I think it motivated other churches and, you know, partners to go ahead and allow us to do the same thing. I just want to say thank you to Elm Grove for allowing us to serve that community. And I'm looking forward to the future ventures. And I think that we have a really good working relationship, and I do see a lot of things to come in the future.
And now, church family, it is time to give back to the Lord a portion of that with which we have been blessed. It is time to worship the Lord through the giving experience. We thank you in advance for being obedient to His word. And so we thank you for being good stewards of the tithe. We know that the tithe is a tenth. It is blessed. The Lord said, if you give to my house, then I will take care of your house. As a matter of fact, I will open up the windows of heaven and pour you out blessings such that you cannot have room enough to receive them. Over and above the tithe is the offering, which is simply a show of love for what the Lord has done in our lives. We want to remind you that we need you to be especially faithful in the giving experience as we prepare our return to in-person worship in the sanctuary at both Elm Grove and New Canaan Baptist Church. On the first Sunday in November, we will return for the very first time in a long time for worship. And you know, in order to do that, we need to be able to prepare our sanctuary to receive us as God's children. It costs to do that. And so we ask you to again be generous, be loving, be joyful in the giving experience. And then we have to remember that at Elm Grove, we are celebrating our 96-year church anniversary, 96 years that God has been good and faithful to us. We ask that you simply give $1 a year for every year that the church has been in existence. So your additional gift of $96 over and above your regular tithes and offerings, and then also a very special gift towards the reopening of the sanctuary in November. We need you to be a blessing to the kingdom. We thank you for your obedience in the giving experience. We pray that God richly blesses you in return. God bless you.
Good morning and happy 96th anniversary, Elm Grove Baptist Church. I am Dakari Williams and I'm from Baton Rouge and I am a member of Elm Grove. However, I live in Atlanta and I must say, God gave me a dream last month. It was of the 6 p.m. service, Communion Sunday, the red carpet. We had Sister Porter praying, breaking chains with our prayers. We had Bro Johnson on his knees singing and edifying God. He was so humble. and praying prayers that I know gave me chills. And Reverend J.R. Williams in that pulpit, shaking the walls, I remember it. I also remember that portrait in the back in the baptismal pool of John the Baptist baptizing Jesus. And John 3:30 says we must decrease so that Jesus can increase. So let's continue to spread the gospel. Hallelujah. Psalm 23:6, that surely goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives. And that's for us, Elm Grove. Rejoice and be happy in it.
Good morning, church family. My name is Denise Smith Duncan, daughter of Isaac and Ann Smith. When I reflect back on my time at Elm Grove, I think of family and community. I have very fond memories of being at Elm Grove. One memory is when I told Brother Woods that we were moving to Texas, and he prayed for me and my son on this next journey in our lives. I think about when my son got baptized, Reverend Domingue baptized him. Think about when I got married, Reverend Domingue, he officiated the ceremony. And I can also take my memories back to when I was a teenager. I'm in the 40 plus club now. But when I was a teenager, I was secretary for Sister Nancy LaMail at the summer school program. And I was also secretary for Vacation Bible School. And I also remember a funny story when my son, I was dropping him off at Vacation Bible School, and Sister Janice Stewart saw me, and I was just about to leave, and she said, "Oh, Denise, I'm glad you're here. I need you to do something for me." And I was like, "Oh man, I thought I was out the door." But I didn't mind, because that goes back to being a sense of family, community, and when I come home, that's exactly what it is. It's home. Happy 96th anniversary, and pray for many more, and the best is yet to come.
Hello, my name is Kathy Holmes Williams. In order to celebrate the 96 years of Elm Grove Baptist Church, we must remember those whose shoulders we stand on, those who sacrificed their all to establish this church, a place to uphold and carry out the commitment to serve the Lord. My mom and dad, Charles and Anna Holmes, set examples and bought some of those first bonds to help establish Elm Grove Baptist Church, and went on to serve in various capacities for many years, such as deacon, trustee, treasurer, Sunday school teacher, deaconess, and biscuit maker. Some of you still remember my mom's famous biscuits. I thank God for my parents, Charles and Anna Holmes, who were guided by the Lord to Elm Grove Baptist Church, and who gave of their time, talent, treasures, and family to serve the Lord, and left a rich legacy of which I am very proud. Wow, 96 years, Elm Grove Baptist Church, 1069 North 38th Street, Baton Rouge, Louisiana. That address will forever be etched in my spirit. Congratulations, Elm Grove, on 96 years of service and commitment, and still standing. Be proud. Be very proud. Congratulations again.
Hello, Elm Grove Church family. My name is Katasha Akins Wilson. I'm the daughter of Minister Lewis and Sister Margie Akins. It was such a privilege to be asked to do this reflections video of my time spent with Elm Grove. 96 years is amazing. I am half of that, but I spent probably 3 decades of my life at Elm Grove. being around the church, being influenced by so many different people in the church, being under the tutelage of Dr. J.R. Williams and Reverend Errol K. Domingue, I learned a lot from both of those gentle giants. And there's so many different pillars in the church, and I don't want to call names because I don't want to miss anyone, but I learned a lot from all of you. Elm Grove is a staple in my life. Funny enough, when I leave and if I move and I have to search for a church home, I still kind of look for that same Elm Grove down home feeling. Some things you just never get away from. And fortunately, I have found that. And still no place like home though. I miss you guys immensely. But my reflections with Elm Grove, it's nothing but fun, love, laughter. Times were well spent, from me being a little girl in Sunday school to singing in the cherubim choir on up until the young adult choir. I don't think I quite made it to that mass choir yet, but it was an amazing time. Every time I get an opportunity to come back home and visit with you all in church, it just reminds me of how much I am missed and how much I miss you all, which is a very comforting feeling. Never thought to think back what it would be like being away from your home church, and to have to do this reflection has really made me think and made me smile on some of the past interactions I've had that I am very grateful for. So I want to say to all of you, while I am no longer a resident of Louisiana, I will always be a member of Elm Grove Baptist Church. You all will always continue to be in my heart. Happy 96th year anniversary. I miss you all and love to you all. God bless.
Elm Grove is a pillar in our community, and the Butterfly Society crossed paths with Elm Grove through Elm Grove being a sponsor, being a partner, being a friend, being family to us, and we work so well together. We mesh, and they're great supporters. What I love about Elm Grove family is when we call, they come. There are change agencies right here in District 7. Pastor Domingue is a past board member of ours. He believes in the work that we're doing as an organization. It's a perfect match, and we're so thankful and grateful for the Elm Grove family. Well, Pastor Domingue and I, we bounce a lot of great ideas off of each other, and we're looking forward to the future. What some of those projects look like. I think we're in the process of working on some things. I know men taking a stand against domestic violence, you know, it's at the center of what we do. But anytime we host an event, anytime we need resources or any type of service provided, Elm Grove is on board. So if the Butterfly decides to do something at the very last minute or at the drop of a hat, all we have to do is pick up the phone and call. And Pastor Domingue and the family here are always so supportive. And I also want to mention that they provide financial support to us as well, where we're able to provide temporary lodging and rental assistance and utility assistance and a number of other services to our victims. So they are always hands-on. And anytime we call, they are there standing with us. I think it's very important to recognize that to have a church with such rich history to sign off on the Butterfly Society, to put its stamp on the Butterfly Society, it really sends a message to the city of Baton Rouge, to the parish of East Baton Rouge Parish, that we're good to go. We're that legit organization. You can believe in us, you can trust us, and Elm Grove has done that for us as well. I want to wish Elm Grove and Pastor Domingue and the family happy anniversary, 96 years of doing great work and great service in the community. You are much needed. Continue to thrive. Continue to be that beacon light, and the Butterfly Society stands with you.
Elm Grove Baptist Church already has been doing so much work in the community around engaging black and brown voters, black and brown folks in general. And so when I received the job at the Power Coalition for Equity and Justice as the faith organizer, it just made sense to seek out such a champion in the community. Elm Grove Baptist Church already has a very good relationship with folks in the Elm Grove area. And then also they were eager to be able to do anything that was helpful for our communities and for folks that look like us. I always tell folks I'm blessed to work with Elm Grove Baptist Church as much as I possibly can. I'm going to be in the room. And so I think this moment, like, we have to relish it and understand how much of a challenge it is for most churches to still have a relationship with folks, a deep-seated relationship outside of just coming to church on Sundays or attending meetings on Saturdays. And so I hope Elm Grove is understanding how big of a deal and how exciting it is for folks to still come to the church and look for those, as I said earlier, resources to some of the things that they may be seeking in the community. And so that's a huge deal, and I'm excited to be a part of that partnership.
Hey, what's good, family? This is our second time coming to you in this manner. I told you before that people ask me, what do I read that informs my preaching? And I've said before that I read all kinds of things. I don't just concentrate on reading the Bible and those books that are related to the Bible, such as commentaries and so forth. I try to read as much as I can get my hands on, both the stuff that I agree with and the stuff of which I don't agree, right? But this is a book, and I happen to agree with this ideology, but this is a book that informs my preaching, or that has, that I've read recently. I would encourage those of you who particularly like history to get your hands on this one. It's entitled Breaking White Supremacy, Martin Luther King Jr. and the Black Social Gospel. It's by a professor at Union Theological Seminary called Gary Dorian. Gary Dorian is his name. And so what this book does for me and helps me to do is to recognize the genealogy of Martin Luther King Jr.'s intellectual and spiritual journey. As I've told you before, that we don't come out of a vacuum, that we don't just pop up on this earth. And so there were people that were used by God to both inform Martin King and to help him to think through. And so this goes way back even before his time, to talk about Mordecai Johnson, who was a president at Howard University, and those people that he hired, such as Benjamin Mays, who had a profound effect on King, and Howard Thurman, who also had a profound effect on King, all the way through. And mentions the preachers that King looked up to and that he listened to as much as he could. So this is a great book if you want to understand, well, what informed how Martin King thought, and how did he get to where he was before the infamous 1963 "I Have a Dream" half speech that they give us. There's a quote in here that you may have heard me say by Adam Clayton Powell, the Reverend Adam Clayton Powell Jr., that I think is powerful and hits all of us. It's on page 218, where Reverend Powell said, "Bad religion does not save. It reinforces ignorance, selfishness, bigotry, and fear." right? And so that was said in the early 20th century, mid to early 20th century, early to mid 20th century. But I think you could say, you can see, we can apply that kind of thinking even today in what we're seeing happening around us. So again, I'd encourage you, if you want to know, well, where does Domingue, how does he think the way he thinks, and where does he get that stuff? Well, check this one out. Breaking White Supremacy, Martin Luther King Jr. and the Black Social Gospel. If you're looking for a scripture reference connected to the beginning of Matthew, where he says Jesus didn't come out of a vacuum, and Matthew goes through the genealogy. Listen, we'll talk again on the books that are on my shelf. I hope that you'll begin to share with me the books that are on your shelf as well. Peace.
Welcome, man, girl. Thank you for joining us. For the first and third Sunday, we'll be live in person in the sanctuary. For the second and fourth, we'll be virtual on our YouTube channel. Thank you for joining us. Now back to your worship.
Yeah.
All right, family, it's time for us to get into the Word of God. Thank God for all of you who have been with us in this worship experience. And shout out to all of you who have worshiped with us in our 96th church anniversary celebration all month long. This month, we've been talking about Tap In. It is our encouragement for us to get involved as we push God's church forward and continue to expand the kingdom of God. And so Tap In suggests that there's something that's good here, something that is beneficial here, and you can't stay on the sidelines, but you have to get involved in what is happening. It will help you. It will help us. And so we spent the month trying to encourage everybody to come on up, get off that sofa, come out of that virtual world in which you've been, in which we have been, honestly, so that we can move forward together in the will and the way and according to the Word of God. And so this is the fifth installment. The fourth installment. We thank God for Reverend Aaron Robinson and our church anniversary message on the second Sunday, but let's close this month out strong. Tap In. This is part four. I'd ask you to join me in the book of Romans. Romans chapter 15, verses 1 through 6 calls our attention. Romans chapter 15, verses 1 through 6. I will read from the New King, from the New International Version. We who are strong ought to bear with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves. Each of us should please our neighbors for their good, to build them up. For even Christ did not please himself, but as it is written, the insults of those who insult you have fallen on me. Verse 4. For everything that was written in the past was written to teach us, so that through the endurance taught in the scriptures and the encouragement they provide, we might have hope. May the God who gives endurance and encouragement give you the same attitude of mind toward each other that Christ Jesus had. Verse 6, so that with one mind and one voice, you may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. That is the reading of God's holy and unchangeable word. Tap In. I wonder if we have given serious consideration to the activity of God in our lives. I mean, beyond, you know, our usual asking God to fulfill our personal needs and to grant us our personal desires. I wonder if you, if we have ever asked him directly or asked directly and indirectly, what in the world is God doing? I mean, when you consider some of the things that we see, some of the things that we hear about, and if we say that our God is providential, that he's in control of everything, don't you wonder sometimes, what is God doing? And even on a personal level, some things that happen to us or don't happen the way that we want them to happen, sometimes we are left to query, even if we don't say it out loud to anybody else, what in the world is God doing? You know what? Let's see if we can come to some conclusions. And I would suggest to you that whether we believe it or not, God does not operate by happenstance. God doesn't operate by coincidence. No, it may seem random to us, but I would suggest to you that God's work is not disconnected at all. In fact, I would tell you that God's work is always directly connected to his plan, and especially his plan for true believers. Remember, the Almighty One said through Jeremiah, the prophet, remember Israel was in exile and God encouraged them to trust trust him in the midst of their troubles by saying to them that I have a plan for you, and it's a, and I have thoughts for you, and it is a plan to prosper you and not to harm you, a plan to give you hope and a future. I may need to say that again, because you don't think you heard that right. God said, I have a plan, and that's a plan to make you prosper. That's a plan to give you hope and a future. That's right. You heard it right. The providential God, who is in control of all that is seen and all that is unseen, yes, says to us, I'm operating with an agenda. Somebody say agenda. God says that my agenda is not about calling a meeting and checking some boxes about what needs to be discussed. No, God says my agenda is about moving you, moving us towards a goal that is God's goal and not our own sometimes. And may I tell you, again, that God has a goal. God is operating by an agenda, not just for the super spiritual, but God is operating by an agenda for, put your name right there in that space. May I tell you about God's agenda? See, you know you're dealing with God's agenda when you find yourself trying to operate and to confront that which God allows and trying to make your way through what God does not allow. You know you are dealing with God's agenda when you recognize that God is doing things His way and God is not doing things our way. That's why we can agree with the Apostle John when he wrote to the churches in Asia Minor, when he said to them, it does not yet appear what we shall be. I'll ask again, may I tell you about God's agenda? In a word, God's agenda for us, for His people, is liberation. Somebody say liberation. No, say it like you heard me. Liberation. You remember, the scriptures say, it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. And so stand firm then, and do not let yourselves be burdened again by the yoke of slavery. God wants you. God wants us as a people to be free, free of that which distorts our thinking, free of that which debilitates our hope, free of that which restrains our physical, our intellectual, and even our spiritual movement and growth. God's agenda is for us to be free. And so God said, I don't want you bound. I don't want you caught up in any kind of an addiction to people and things and chemicals, whether we want to admit it or not. God says, I don't want you to be bound or restrained by from a vision that allows you to see things only your way and God, not God's way. God does not want us to be caught up in a venomous hatred and jealousy in our hearts. No, God wants to break us free from trusting he, she, or it that does not deserve our trust. God's agenda for us is liberation. And now, if the Lord's agenda is liberation, and if God wants us to be free, then it means that what we think and what we say and what we speak, especially about ourselves, ought to be in harmony with God. And that means that we not only seek our own freedom, but we act like Harriet Tubman and set free as many as we can. Can I say that again? It means that if God's agenda is freedom, then that means that our agenda ought to be freedom, not just for ourselves, but that we go back and set free as many as we can. See, that probably seems kind of strange to some of us, because so many of us have had our minds conditioned by the American Western capitalist enterprise that is contradictory to the kingdom of God freedom agenda. You know, American Western enterprise, that claims to operate by free enterprise and that claims to use democracy and an agenda, when the fact of the matter is free enterprise and democracy looks good on paper, but the way that it is operated in our contemporary setting, it only means to protect the property and the interest of the haves while maintaining, even if it has to destroy the have-nots. And when that happens, and when we get caught up into that kind of thinking, we become mentally and spiritually trapped by such notions to the place that we are confused, and we think that equality equals freedom. I need to say that again. When that happens, when we buy into that stuff, into that foolishness, we begin to think that equality equals freedom. And that's when we believe if we could just have what they have. That's when we believe if we could just do what they do. That's when we believe if we can just be equal with them, then we too will be free. But the fact of the matter is, that's what leads to bondage, because that's not freedom at all, because you are tied to always trying to seek power and money. So then rather than seeking the kingdom of God and his righteousness, we seek the approval of godless women and men. So then rather than striving for that which is good for us, we grow to hate ourselves, even to the place that we hate those who remind us of ourselves. Rather than seeking real freedom, we despise and try to crush the name, the character, and even the personhood of anybody we think stands in the way of our gaining more stuff and gaining access and gaining approval for the so-called dominant culture. And yeah, they are the global minority. See, believe me when I tell you, believe me when I tell you that our Nubian Redeemer, Jesus the Christ, was not lynched on a cross and raised from the dead so that we could have equality in a system that was not designed and does not operate for us. God wants us to be free, free in our minds, free in our movement, free in our finances. God wants us to be free. You don't believe me? Check what the record says. March through history as it is recorded in our sacred scripture, and you will find that way back in the book of Exodus, God told Moses to meet Pharaoh at the Nile and tell Pharaoh, let my people go so that they could go into the wilderness and worship me in freedom. Don't you remember? God sent prophetic word after prophetic word to set Israel free from idolatry that would eventually lead to their exile. And who can forget that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son to set us free from ourselves before we destroyed ourselves. And then somebody remembers that God has sent his Holy Spirit to set us free from insecurity, to set us free from indecision as it relates to him, to set us free from stammering in his will and in his way. Are we still together? Is this working? Check it again. Let's go a little deeper. And what you will recognize is this freedom that I'm talking about, this kind of freedom does not happen in isolation. It requires community. I know you've heard me mention it before, but I need to go there again on us. This kind of freedom requires community. See, while it is true that we who are the believers And we who make up the universal ecclesia, that's the church, we are set apart by God. But God never meant for us to live separate from reality and humanity. See, one of the tricks of the forces of evil is to have us operate in what we can call isolation. Somebody say isolation. See, those who don't want the best for us, those who seek to control us, and those who want to profit off our pain, one of the tricks that they use is to separate us, even if they have to isolate us in our own minds. And you know what? That's a trick that's not new, it's not innovative, and it's not impassable, but it is effective. See, as long as we retreat to our own homes and our own families, as long as we seek to exclude more than we want to include, as long as we think that we are the only ones that can be right, as long as we think we're the only ones that are going through, as long as we don't participate unless we have a prominent role, as long as we are the only, as we only want to perform and do business and to produce with and move forward with those who are like us, we will never realize and operate in the power of knowing that, here's one, check it, that we are the standard. Ooh, you better write that one down. We are the standard. See, as long as the forces of evil can keep us isolated from one another, we will never realize that we are the standard. May I explain myself to you? You see, science, even science, has agreed with God when God told us that the first humans were created in Africa, and they looked like you and I. When God made humans, he made them complete, and God made them in his own image and likeness. That means that God thinks so much of us that he says that we are little gods. So that lets us know that we should not lower our standards to seek equality and likeness in attitude and in behavior, and I dare say even in stuff, with anyone who would reject the power and the presence of God. It's because God lives in our consciousness, and God has invested in us that we can declare and we can proclaim and we can hold to the fact that when God made us, God made the standard. We may not have the credentials other people want us to have. We may not have the stuff that other people have, not even as it contributes to material wealth. We may not even have the physical attributes of what this world calls beautiful. But baby, can I tell you that when it comes to the truth, when it comes to righteousness, when it comes to uprightness, when it comes to morals and ethics, when it comes to strength to endure, when it comes to imagination and innovation, we are the standard. And I need you to recognize, this is not some abstract idea. No, this speaks to us as individuals and as a collective. And that says to us that we have to reject any label or any language that seeks to divide us in our own minds, or to make us think more highly or lowly of ourselves than we should. God made us, and he made us perfect in his own eyes. You are God's standard of what the world wants to see in him. Did you hear that? You are God's standard of what God wants the world to see in him and about him. God wants the world to be able to look at you and see how to maintain in both good times and bad times. God wants the world to look at you and to see how to prosper even when other people don't want you to prosper. God wants the world to look at you and see how to remain loyal. That's love. When disloyalty, that's hate, is trending in our world, God wants the world to look at you and see how to remain true to yourself in this lying world. If we follow the idea, the ideology and the perspective of the world, we will never realize and we will never operate, and here's number two, we will never realize and never operate in the knowledge that we are the global majority. Did you hear that? We are the global majority. I wish I had my t-shirt. We are the global majority. See, isolation is only effective when we think that we are alone, when we think that we're the only ones, as long as we don't communicate with one another. That's why we hear the rhetoric of the propaganda mass media machine that tries to convince us that we are the minority. That's why the dirty and the low down, you know, the ones that physically and psychologically abuse their significant others, try to keep them separate and apart from their family and friends. That's why those who take advantage and do the work of the devil to steal, kill, and destroy your bank account, your dignity, and sometimes even your future don't want you talking to anybody else. But I think I told you, and I know you remember, just a month ago, I told you, don't be afraid. The prophet said, those who are with us are more than than those who are with them. Don't you remember that John, when he wrote, John said, he that is in, that is within you is greater than he that is in the world. So that's why. That's why in just about every message you hear me use the phrase dominant culture, yet global minority. We are not the minority. In fact, you ought to consider the 1 billion black people who are on the continent right now, and the vast numbers of those of us who are in the diaspora. We are not the minority. And therefore, we are called to think beyond our present conditions and to realize that we have more who are with us than they that are against us. We are called. Did you hear me? We are called to connect with the brothers and sisters who are across towns, connect across denominations, connect across faith traditions. Are you still with me? We're called to connect with brothers and sisters across our country. In fact, I would suggest to you that we have to learn to take it further and connect with sisters and brothers in Mozambique or in Pretoria or in São Paulo or in St. Vincent or in Toronto or in Brixton. You know why? Because when we come together, we are a force that cannot be stopped. Now, I know I'm tripping you out. God is tripping me out in this moment too. But I need you to know, dear heart, that this is not ordinary thinking in the church, and I dare say even in the black church. So let me make my next point. It lets me know that at this time, if you believe God, and if you believe that God speaks through me, then God is calling for a different kind of believer. That's what Paul was up to when he wrote this particular section to the believers in Rome. He was calling for a different kind of believer. Paul was telling the believer, we got to be different than those who acquiesce to the Jewish system, who demand loyalty to the law above the grace of Jesus Christ. God was saying through Paul, don't be like those Corinthians who find a way to separate themselves and to stratify themselves according to the ways of the world and not trusting the will and the way of God. God was saying through Paul, that we have to be different than those who wanted to serve and to worship the Lord according to our own terms, rather than surrendering ourselves to Him on His terms. So I suppose I suppose that's what this month of Tap In has been all about. Calling for, God calling for, a different kind of a believer. Yeah, so God calls us even now as we move forward, as we think that we are coming out of this so-called pandemic. God says that means we have to think differently. We have to move differently. We have to interact differently. See, this is a call for a different kind of believer that wants to heal and press forward rather than remain stagnant and lick our wounds. A different kind of believer that wants to demonstrate straight salvation and justice. And I'm not saying that this is anything that has not happened before. Just like the world is shook right now, the world has been shaken before. I do believe that Professor Radio host Karen Hunter was right about it. When you really think about it, we are still dealing with a pandemic that probably could have been avoided in this country. And don't you ever let them make you forget that January 6, 2021, treasonous insurrection where they turned on themselves. And now they are trying to just hit the reset button and go back to what used to be, when the fact of the matter, if you look closely and if you listen to them talk and talk to one another, the roof is on fire. So I suggest that's why we better pay closer attention to what Paul said in verse 4. Everything that was written in the past was written to teach us, so that through the endurance taught in the scriptures and the encouragement they provide, we might have hope. Somebody say a different kind of believer. Yep. It has happened before, and God is calling us to not only check out, but to model what he has done before with people who loved him and loved his people, but would not acquiesce to the word, to the world, a different kind of believer, a kind of believer like Ida B. Wells, Ida Barnett Wells. She was Christian, and she taught us to speak up and to act up, especially in the face of state-sponsored and state-sanctioned lynching in this country. A different kind of believer like Marcus Garvey, who was both Catholic and Ethiopian Orthodox Christian, that called us to stand up and make our own opportunities and not live as doormats for white supremacy. A different kind of believer like Septima Clark, who was United Methodist, and she taught us the power of organization and of grassroots movements. A different kind of believer like Martin Luther King Jr., you know, a Baptist minister who taught us to demand respect for our humanity while we fight that three-headed monster of militarism, of materialism, and of racism that's attacking God's people all over the globe. A different kind of believer like Fannie Lou Hamer, a Baptist layperson who taught us to get off our knees and do something about what we're praying about. A different kind of believer like Dr. Jeremiah Wright, who grew up Baptist but pastored in the United Church of Christ tradition that taught us to be unashamedly black and unapologetically Christian. A different kind of believer like Sister Tracy Blackman, or Reverend Tracy Blackman, who teaches us that you can pray about it and talk about it, but sooner than later you gotta show up and do something about it. Somebody say a different kind of believer. Well, I think I've tried to get you to see the importance of Tap In, right? That if your life is going to take off from here, if you're going to live up to your potential, you got to tap in to what God is already doing. In fact, tap in to God's agenda for your life. And it will require that you become a different kind of believer, different than those who want to just go to church, sit down for an hour or so on Sunday, and go on living as if God doesn't exist. A different kind of believer, not one that wants the church to be just the religious arm of the American enterprise. A different kind of believer that's serious about Matthew 6:33, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and his righteousness, and his righteousness. And God will do what only God can do in your life. Well, I'll leave you alone. But I got to tell you what God has taught me through. See, you think you're the only one learning. But as God teaches me, then it's my job to teach you. I want you to look again when you get a chance at verses 5 and 6. This is in a real sense a doxology, and maybe even leans over to a benediction. It starts with, may the God who gives endurance and encouragement give you the same attitude of mind toward each other that Christ Jesus had. Verse 6 says, so that with one mind and one voice, somebody say tap in, so that with one mind and one voice, you may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. You want to know what God has taught me? You see, in this season, of solemnity and solace during this so-called pandemic, God has told me, don't give up, don't give in, and don't give out. God told me to operate in harmony with him, and he will send those who are willing to operate in harmony with me. Did you hear that? When you decide that you're going to walk according or live according to God's agenda, God will send the ones into your life who are willing to operate just like you, according to what God is doing and not according to what the world is doing. See, God taught me, yes, that it's not all about me. Did you hear that? God taught me that it's not all about me. See, God said, everybody doesn't have to be like you. And everybody doesn't have to think like you. And everybody doesn't have to move like you. God taught me, yes, that everybody doesn't have to have the same belief system. And everybody doesn't have to call him by the same name. And everybody doesn't have to share the same memories and be from the same generation. And everybody doesn't have to have the same depth of knowledge as it relates to God and his word. But we all have to be dedicated to God. And we all have to find ourselves dedicated to living up to our best. And we all have to find ourselves dedicated to God's agenda. So God told me it's going to take all of that. And that's what I came to tell you as we close this message. It's going to take all of that. If we're going to impact the world the way God wants us to, yes, if they will ever see God in his truest sense and not through the lens of American enterprise, if they're going to claim and proclaim their rightful place in the Lord, then God says it's going to take all of that. It's going to take the way what's next crowd, and is going to take the nostalgia leaning crowd, is going to take all of that, is going to take diverse approaches to the same liberation agenda, is going to take all of that, the phonographic generation, the 8-track tape generation, the cassette tape generation, the compact disc generation, and the digital download generation. Did you hear me? It's going to take all of that. It's going to take those who believe in the inerrant word of God, and it's going to take those who only look for the life lessons in the word. It's going to take all of that. It's going to take those who don't know anything but the church, and it's going to take those who don't know anything but the street and everybody in between. It's going to take all of that. It's going to take those whose sins we know about, and it's going to take those who do a better job of hiding their sins. It's going to take all of that. It will take those who agree with your decisions and your choices, and is going to take those who respectfully disagree with what we decide. It's going to take, did you hear that? It's going to take all of that. Now, I guess you're wondering where I'm going with this. See, I knew I would be preaching to some smart people. Yes. So I took a closer look at the text, and what I recognized is, yes, that Paul said that the ultimate goal is to glorify God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's not to have the biggest church. It's not to have the biggest budget. It's not to have the best friends or the best network. It's not to have, yes, the best of what the world says. It's to glorify God. Yes, and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. I took a close look at the word glorified, and the word glorified is directly connected to the idea of praising God. Did you hear that? When they said, when Paul said, we have to glorify God, what Paul said, what Paul meant is, yes, that our lives, not just our mouths, but our lives ought to praise God. And I need to tell you that it's all right to praise God in your individual dance, and it's all right to praise God in your song, and it's all right to praise God all by yourself, but I came to tell you that you can't really glorify God. You can't really give God your best and set your mind on the things of God to the fullest. Yes, on your own. You see, we can't really magnify the Lord and leave some people out. We can't magnify the Lord and pick and choose who we praise with. We can't magnify the Lord and look down our ecclesiastical noses at some people while we accept other people. That's why David said, oh, magnify the Lord with me and let us exalt his name. Somebody finish it together. So here we are. So here we are. God is calling you. God is calling us to tap in together, to be more inclusive than we are exclusive. God is calling us to tap in together and stretch beyond our present condition, because there are more who are with us than those who are against us. Tap in and you will see that the same thing, the same issues, the same struggles, and even the same victories that's happening on your street are happening on streets all across this globe. And the worst thing that the devil or evil wants to happen is for the people of God, especially those whose skin has been kissed by the African sun, to realize that we are not the minority. We are the majority. We are not struggling to become what they want. We are already the standard, and we are becoming more the standard of what God wants. God bless you. God keep you. I hope that you've been a part of. I hope that you learn that you've been strengthened and encouraged and empowered by this month, our 96th church anniversary celebration here at Elm Grove. But we don't exclude people, right? Wherever, especially our sisters and brothers in New Canaan, and from wherever you have come to worship with us, we are grateful. We in this thing together. The 96th church anniversary is a celebration, a marked time, but it don't stop God's work. We are in this thing together. Listen, let me now quickly, but no less importantly, invite you to relationship with God. There's some instructions that are posted on the screen. I want you to follow them. You need to connect. You need to tap in. You need to tap in with us, right? Become a part of God's movement, God's agenda. Listen, I don't care where you've been, what you've done, or what was done to you. God has not pushed you away. God is trying to pull you in. You fit in. I know the church people act funny sometimes. We have our issues, but you fit with what God is doing. And so accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior by believing that He died on the cross, but that God raised Him from the dead. That's a wonderful story. You need to let us tell you about that story. Or join us, become a part of our faith communities, New Canaan and Elm Grove. And then lastly, if you need someone to pray with you, please just type connect in the box. Follow the prompts. Connect with us through information at elmgrovebc.org, and someone from our team will be with you in very short order. Again, I'm praying, man, that we press forward as a result of what we heard. I know it's allergy season for me, but the word still went forward. The devil can't stop what God has decided. Please receive the Lord's blessings on your life, and now the Lord bless you and the Lord keep you. The Lord lift up His face upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up His countenance unto you and give you peace and help and hope and prosperity and justice and good success in your every endeavor. And let all of the people of God say amen. That means we agree. And ashe, that says it shall be. Peace.
Thank you for tuning into our youth service this month. Please remember to share, like, and subscribe to our YouTube channel and sow into our youth ministry. I hope you enjoyed this service as much as I did. Thank you again and have a blessed week.